Our next speaker needs no presentation. As all of us know, signaling is very important in cell communication within the cell and outside the cell. And our next speaker has been a pioneer in studying signaling, in particular in neurons. And you have recognized our next speaker, Thomas Sudow, who actually was born in Göttingen in Germany, and now he works in Stanford, I guess. And because of his several important discoveries, the committee in Stockholm had selected him for this prestigious prize. It's therefore a privilege to introduce our next speaker. Please.
When Thomas is approaching the, the table, I may say that Thomas was in Moscow several times. He's our friend. He has several postdocs from Moscow. And we are really very, very glad to see him. First time it was in the Galgat Institute. And Mirzabekov welcomed him, and I was chairing his first seminar in Moscow, I guess. Thank you, Thomas, for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this kind introduction. Thank you, Sasha, for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to talk to you today, this afternoon, about a project that has its roots, actually, in this very institute. In fact, much what I'm going to tell you about wouldn't have been possible without the legacy of Ovchinnikov and without the work of two former postdoctoral fellows in my lab who spent some time with me in the beginning of the 90s and then went on to their own ways. Yuri Ushkaryov, who is now in England, and Sasha Petrenko, who is sitting right there. And who did much of the pioneering work I'm going to discuss. What I'm going to tell you about today is outlined in this slide. I'm going to first give you a brief introduction to the overall subject. Instead of then giving you, trying to tell you some kind of overview, giving you a review of the subject, I will present two projects, recent projects, that give you a feeling for the challenge that I'm trying to introduce you in my introduction, the challenge of understanding the brain, to put it sort of in a nutshell, which is a different beast, a different kind of challenge from understanding mycoplasma. And you have just heard how difficult it is to understand the mycoplasma. So the brain is really quite complicated. This is a personal perspective as well. I'm trying with this talk to communicate to you some of the principles that we need to understand in order to understand the brain. What you see here is a picture of a human brain, a dead brain, I'm afraid. It's a big organ. Woody Allen famously said it's the second most important organ. Don't ask me what the first one is. Composed of trillions of neurons that are connected into vast overlapping networks, circuits, by thousands of synapses per neuron. If you compare that to the complexity of the genome, it is immediately apparent that we have a problem. The genome itself contains only some 22,000 genes. There is clearly no relationship, no linear direct relationship between genomes, transcriptomes, and how the brain works. Understanding the brain is probably, arguably, one of the major challenges in biomedical research. There's been a lot of discussion of what's the best way of trying to approach it. Sometimes amicable discussions, sometimes not amicable, but always centered on what is actually there to be understood in the first place. Despite these disagreements, neuroscientists generally can talk to each other at a level of understanding that is the circuit. A circuit is illustrated here in this slide here, is basically neurons connected by synapses. It is thought that the brain processes information by transferring and computing that information between neurons at these synapses. Synapses are specialized junctions that compute information by changing action potential patterns, spike patterns, during the transfer from one neuron to the next. What you see here schematically is a very simple circuit, feed-forward inhibition circuit, where a blue excitatory cell excites a postsynaptic blue, another excitatory cell, and also a red inhibitory cell. By exciting the inhibitory cell, this provides feed-forward inhibition, because the inhibitory cell then inhibits the downstream postsynaptic excitatory cell. What this slide also illustrates is that a circuit diagram alone doesn't tell us how the information processing actually is going to work, because neurons don't fire in isolation, they fire in bursts and trains. The transfer of information at synapses is plastic. It differs between synapses, and it cannot actually be predicted how the postsynaptic blue cell here will respond to a given presynaptic action potential pattern. It all depends on the specific properties of the synapses that are being involved. The rules that determine synapse formation and synapse properties, that determine how circuits are built and how the synapses within a circuit function, are largely unknown. And this is really the subject that I've been interested in for the last years and that I want to talk to you about today. The overall hypothesis is that there must be some kind of logic that is mediated by molecules, thus a molecular logic, that shapes synaptic connections, and that, at least in part, this logic is affected by transsynaptic signals across the synaptic cleft via cell adhesion molecules that are bidirectionally signaled. An implication here is that there is nothing like a master molecule. There is not a single explanation for things like synapse formation and the determination of synapse properties. Instead, that's similar to an orchestra where there's many instruments that provide the overall sound, a synapse, the properties of a synapse, are the result of many players that cooperate and collaborate. This is where neuroxins and latrophilins come in. What I'm going to tell you about today in my two exemplary stories is that these molecules mediate facets of synapse formation and specification. All of this started with a black widow spider that you can see here in this beautiful picture, very well known for its gracious and often exemplary, maybe imitatable, mating behaviors. Also important, because it produces a number of toxins, including alpha-latrotoxin, that binds to mammalian presynaptic nerve terminals and triggers neurotransmitter release. Not only neuroxins, but also latrophilins were identified by affinity chromatography on purified alpha-lactotoxin and are thus alpha-lactotoxin receptors. Neurexins are typical type 1 membrane proteins. They're shown schematically here in green. They come in two variants, alpha and beta neurexins, that are transcribed from the same genes. There are three genes in mammals that have independent promoters for alpha and beta neurexins. Neurexins are subject to extensive alternative splicing that creates thousands of isoforms. And they've been implicated in a number of neuropsychiatric disorders, in particular schizophrenia more than anything. In fact, they are still the single most frequent single gene mutation in schizophrenia. When you look at the structure of neurexins, it's obvious that they must have postsynaptic interaction partners. They actually bind to many postsynaptic ligands, including those shown here. What I'm demonstrating here are just four of these ligands. They all bind to both alpha and beta neurexins because they all interact with their common last LNS domain, as shown here, characterized with an L. Otherwise, these molecules have little in common. In particular, they have no structural motif that they share. There's nothing like a neurexin binding motif. However, interestingly, these four ligands that I'm showing here are also regulated by alternative splicing of neurexins. The extensive alternative splicing of neurexins early on led to the hypothesis that neurexins might mediate some kind of information signal that is regulated by alternative splicing. This hypothesis, which I will discuss later on in more detail, was further supported by the observation that at least those ligands here, shown here, are regulated by alternative splicing at one particular site called splice site number 4. And they are regulated in a manner that's different for each ligand. For example, cerebellins bind only when there is an insert in that alternatively spliced sequence, whereas LRTMs only bind if there is no insert. Neural ligands, shown here in blue, sometimes bind and sometimes don't, depending on the isoform and the splice variant of neural ligands themselves. Note that I show here latrophilins as a postsynaptic molecule, something that I will discuss a little bit later, which is maybe a bit surprising to some of you because it is, after all, a latrotoxin receptor which acts presynaptically. So much for my introduction. Let me now tell you specifically about those two projects that I wanted to inform you about. One of them, the first one, deals with one of the three neurexin genes, neurexin 3, the one neurexin we understand best at this point. And it shows you how we try to approach a better understanding of how cell adhesion molecules may shape synapses. The starting point of this project was the generation of conditional knockout mice that delete all the transcripts of neurexin 3, all alpha and beta transcripts, and that were necessary because constitutive knockout mice were lethal. When we analyzed these conditional knockout mice in cultured neurons, as shown here, that were infected with lentiviruses expressing either mutant control Cre recombinase, or Cre recombinase, shown here in red, what we found was a rather surprising phenotype. What we observed specifically was that AMPA receptor-mediated EPSCs were decreased by about 50%, whereas NMDA receptor-mediated EPSCs were not. Also, iPSCs were normal. This was surprising because the fact that the NMDA receptor-mediated EPSCs were normal meant that glutamate release was normal and suggested a postsynaptic phenotype, suggested that there was a change postsynaptically, even though we contended that neurexin 3 is presynaptic. Indeed, further studies demonstrated that miniature EPSCs were also decreased in amplitude, consistent with the loss of postsynaptic receptors. To test this directly, we measured postsynaptic receptors using immunocytochemistry, and we found that indeed, when we quantified postsynaptic surface glutamate receptors, GluA1, or for that matter, GluA2, not shown here, that there was a massive decrease. Specifically, the density of synaptic puncta was unchanged, as measured either by GluA1, PSD95, or the presynaptic marker VGlut1. However, the size of the GluA1 puncta, which is equivalent or measures the concentration of GluA1 receptors, was decreased, equivalent to the decrease of the EPSC. There was a trend for PSD95 as a postsynaptic marker. There was no change in VGlut1. Levels of glutamate receptors were unchanged, demonstrating that there's a loss of surface glutamate receptors as a result of this global deletion of neurexin 3. This loss was caused by increased AMPA receptor endocytosis, led us to wonder whether the neurons developed in a some way abnormal manner and whether this phenotype could actually be rescued by reintroduction of neurexin 3 after or during the deletion. We did this, as shown here, by analyzing neurexin 3 alpha and neurexin 3 beta containing or lacking an insert in splice site number 4. And we found that re-expression of neurexin 3 alpha or 3 beta lacking an insert fully rescued the phenotype, suggesting that it's not a developmentally fixed phenotype and that both alpha and beta can rescue. However, as shown here on the right, when these neurexin 3 molecules had an insert in the splice site number 4, it could not rescue, raising the possibility that the function of neurexin 3 that was reflected here was splice site dependent. Neurexin 3 contains the splice site 4, like all neurexins, in an extracellular sequence in the last LNS domain, suggesting that this is a function that is mediated by an extracellular interaction of neurexin 3. To further understand this, we tested whether simply expressing neurexin 3 on the surface of neurons anchored by a lipid molecule, a GPI moiety, could actually rescue the phenotype, and we found it could. SS4 minus neurexin 3 alpha, or 3 beta for that matter, that was lipid anchored, fully rescued the phenotype, so just displaying it on the surface was sufficient. On the other hand, using a secreted splice variant of neurexin 3 led to a loss of rescue, as shown here on the right. So these experiments suggested that the surface display of SS4 minus neurexin 3 mediates in some manner an AMPA receptor stabilization in the synapses. However, these experiments have several raised questions and have several problems. One is that rescue of phenotypes is always overexpression, and overexpression is always a problem. The other one is that in culture, you never know whether you're really dealing with a true phenomenon or whether that's just a culture phenomenon. In neuroscience, that's a big deal. And finally, we couldn't actually tell from these experiments if this was a presynaptic effect, that is, if presynaptic neurexins had a postsynaptic function, or if neurexins, after all, do have a postsynaptic function. And so to address these questions, we used a genetic approach. We used a genetic approach that instead of just deleting all of neurexins, we introduced into the neurexin gene a point mutation that changes alternative splicing at splice site number 4. Specifically, splice site number 4 involves the inclusion or exclusion of an exon, exon 20, shown here in blue. When this exon is included, it's SS4 plus. When it's excluded, it's SS4 minus. That exon has an unusual splice acceptor sequence, as shown here in the wild type in black. We mutated this unusual splice acceptor sequence into a splice acceptor sequence that is canonical. By doing so, the axon became no longer alternatively spliced, but was always included. We also flanked the axon with LOX-P sites shown here in green diagram, in green triangles, allowing us to constitutively exclude the axon with Cre recombinase. Thus, in these mice, this knock-in causes constitutive inclusion of SS4. Cre recombinase causes constitutive excision. When we analyzed cultured neurons from these knock-in mice as a proof of principle, we found that in hippocampal cultured neurons, the SS4 plus version had the same phenotype as the neurexin 3 alpha beta deletion. So neurexin 3 SS4 plus was non-functional in these synapses, whereas excision of the SS4 plus into an SS4 minus rescued the phenotype shown here in green in comparison to the black wild type. This was also true for all the other phenotypes we analyzed, suggesting that, that truly the function of neurexin 3 in maintaining AMPA receptors was tightly regulated by alternative splicing at SS4. We then wondered whether this is really a presynaptic, sort of transsynaptic mechanism, or whether this is a cell autonomous mechanism, and to whether this type of action occurs in vivo. To analyze this, we used a preparation that we like very much for a number of reasons, where we inject stereotactically adeno-associated viruses encoding either Cre recombinase or a control protein, both labeled with EGFP, here in the CA1 region of the hippocampus at P21. 2 weeks later, we cut slices, and we then analyze electrophysiologically the projections that the CA1 parameter neurons send to the subiculum, marked here with an S. We analyze this by patching subiculum neurons and stimulating the axons with a stimulating electrode. In this manner, we can specifically manipulate a presynaptic neuron without ever changing the postsynaptic neuron, and we can analyze synapses emanating from the presynaptic neurons but formed on postsynaptic subiculum neurons. One potential complication here, which actually turns out to be very useful, is the fact that the subiculum neurons are heterogeneous. The pyramidal neurons in the subiculum are composed of two types of neurons, which are called regular-firing neurons because they fire regularly, and burst-firing neurons because, you guess it, these two types of neurons can be easily distinguished. They do not only have different intrinsic electrical properties, but they also have different forms of plasticity. They have different forms of long-term LTP, long-term plasticity LTP. The regular-firing neurons have a classical NMDA receptor-dependent LTP. The burst-firing neurons have a presynaptic form of LTP that's cyclic AMP-dependent. Thus, this preparation allows analysis specifically of presynaptic manipulations on synaptic strength and on two different forms of long-term plasticity. Using this preparation both for the knock-in mice and, in fact, for the conditional knockout mice, which I'm not showing, we found that presynaptic inclusion of splice site 4 or presynaptic excision of neurexin 3 caused the same loss of AMPA receptor-mediated EPSCs as in culture, as shown here in the blue for the SS4 plus compared to the presynaptic excision, which is the CA1 Cre in green. This experiment showed that this was true for both types of subiculum neurons, demonstrating that presynaptic alternative splicing dictates postsynaptic AMPA receptor content. We also measured LTP, and to our surprise, we found that regular NMDA receptor-dependent LTP in regular firing cells was almost completely blocked by presynaptic inclusion of SS4, but rescued by presynaptic excision of SS4. Thus, what these experiments show is that a presynaptic molecule, in this case neuraxin 3, via alternative splicing can transsynaptically regulate the properties of the postsynaptic response, which has implications for how we think about how in a circuit postsynaptic responses are regulated. The presynaptic type of RTP that's present in burst-firing subiculum neurons was not affected. So these experiments establish that neuraxin 3 in these hippocampal circuits has a function in specifying synapses. It has no role in actually determining the number of synapses, but it basically regulates the properties of the synapse. Is this the universal function of neuraxin 3? It turns out it's not, maybe not surprisingly. Instead of telling you this in great detail, I'm just going to give you one example. Olfactory bulb neurons in culture or in slices show a completely different phenotype. Here, with the deletion of neuraxin 3, AMPA and NMDA receptor iPSCs are normal, but now inhibitory synapses, iPSCs, are severely impaired. This impairment is due to a different mechanism than that I showed you for the AMPA receptor phenotype in hippocampal circuits. It's independent of splice site number 4 alternative splicing because it can be rescued, as shown here, with an SS4 plus neuraxin 3 alpha, as demonstrated here. However, it does require the intracellular sequences of neuraxin 3 because it cannot be rescued with a GPI-anchored neuraxin 3 alpha, demonstrating that the mechanism is totally different. Different types of neurons, different mechanisms. So to summarize this part of the talk, what I have told you about is that in the hippocampus, there's a transsynaptic function of neuraxins in dictating postsynaptic AMPA receptor content, at least as regards neuraxin 3. This, surprisingly, this function also regulates or gates the postsynaptic ability to undergo long-term plasticity in an NMDA receptor-dependent manner, and is regulated by alternative splicing, providing alternative splicing a biological rationale. In olfactory bulb, it's totally different. It's a cell-autonomous presynaptic function that controls release probability and is splice site 4 independent. Thus, these two different types of synapses involve neuraxin 3 in completely different functions. How can we understand this? I think we have to look at an atomic high-resolution model of neuraxin 3. What you see here is neuraxin 3 in its beauty. You have recognized it immediately, and you can see that in this comparison picture, which is actually a Swiss Army knife, but anyway. The point here is that it's a signaling platform. You have different bells and whistles that do different things. For example, the corkscrew, you can imagine, is involved in regulating postsynaptic AMPA receptors. The scissors and NMDA receptor-dependent RTP. Another part on release probability. Another part regulates postsynaptic endocannabinoids synthesis, something I hadn't time to discuss, and. There's more to come. So why do different neuraxin function in different circuits so differently? I think that one reason for that is that, as I indicated earlier, we believe that neuraxins basically form just one facet in a multi-component system in which many other molecules are involved. And they together shape the overall response. And we are just looking selectively at one particular component. Let me move on to the last part of my talk, latrophilins. And specifically, latrophilin 2, where, as I will tell you, the function is a completely different one. Now, some of you may never have heard of latrophilins, And I have to apologize to Sasha Petrenko for actually naming them latrophilins. I have resisted naming them latrophilins for a long time, because when they were initially cloned, both by Sasha Petrenko's lab and later by Yuri Oshkario's lab, my two former postdocs, they gave them different names. And so I tried to keep both names, but I've given up, because as things go, there's some authority that names genes, and they have named this gene latrophilin. And so I just felt obliged to adopt that name, because that's what's out there. So latrophilins, as I mentioned, were initially purified and cloned by both Sasha Petrenko and Yuri Oshkariov, and they have a very interesting domain structure that is illustrated in this slide here. They are GPCRs. They belong to its cell adhesion GPCRs, which is a class of 33 genes in humans that is characterized by having both a classical GPCR, 7 transmembrane architecture, and a very large extracellular assembly of domains that is different for different cell adhesion GPCRs, but which always share one domain, which we call the gain domain. In the case of the latrophilins, the extracellular domains include a lectin domain or a factomedon-like domain, a hormone binding domain, and the gain domain that I already mentioned, followed by the GPCR 7 transmembrane region in a relatively large cytoplasmic region. What is interesting, as first described actually by Sasha Petrenko, is that latrophilins undergo an autoproteolysis reaction right outside of the membrane at a sequence that he has named the GPS. This GPS, as it turns out, is part of a larger domain whose crystal structure we determined in collaboration with Axel Brünger a couple of years ago, and that mediates the autoproteolysis at the GPS, and that we call the gain domain, to illustrate, sort of encapsulate the whole thing. And that is shown here as the gain domain with a hormone binding domain attached to the 7 transmembrane regions. Importantly, autoproteolysis doesn't necessarily cause a dissociation of the two parts, because even after the proteolysis, the finger of the GPS sticks firmly in the gain domain and can only be dissociated by force. The gain domain is a large, autonomously folded, evolutionarily conserved domain that all adhesion GPCRs contain, although the reason for proteolysis is still unknown. Another point of interest about latrophilins is that in recent years, again, multiple ligands were described that bind to latrophilins with high affinity, including, as shown here, tenurins, nurexins, and fluorts, all of which are cell adhesion molecules in their own rights. These transcellular interactions mediated by these binding reactions create junctions, suggesting that latrophilins may, just like nurexins, be involved in synapse formation or synapse function. As multivalent cell adhesion molecules, latrophilins could potentially shape synapses similar to nurexins, or they could have a totally different functions. So the first issue that we raised was where latrophilins are really localized and what do they do. And we addressed this by targeting specifically latrophilin 2, one of the 3 latrophilin genes in the mammalian genome. What we did, as illustrated in the slide here, is generate mice in which there is a knock-in of a tagged latrophilin which contains a venous, an M-venous sequence to make it fluorescent. This knock-in can be converted into a conditional knockout by simple combinatorial flip recombinase excision. Thus, in these mice, we created both a knock-in that expresses latrophilin as an M-venous fusion protein, and it is itself conditional, and a conditional knockout, with the M-venous, as shown here on the right, being located in the cytoplasmic tail. When you pursue a strategy such as this one, the most important concern is that the labeling, the tagging of the protein may actually destroy its function. To test this, we compared the survival of knock-in mice and knock-out mice. What we found, as shown here, is that homozygous constitutive knockouts that were created from the conditional knockouts are lethal. They don't survive, so cladophilin 2 is essential. However, the knock-in that expresses M-venous tag cladophilin survives perfectly well, as shown here in green, demonstrating that the knock-in molecule containing M-venous is perfectly functional, that it works, and thus allowing us to use that endogenous tag cladophilin for functional analysis. When we looked at the location of this molecule, we found that in cultured hippocampal neurons, as well as in vivo, it is at least in part concentrated in synapses, as illustrated here for cultured neurons. So what effect does the cladophilin 2 knockout have on synapses? To test this, we initially used a preparation where we specifically delete a molecule by transfection in cultured neurons from only a small subset of the neurons. In this way, we test for cell autonomous postsynaptic functions. When we did this for the cladophilin 2 knockout in cultured hippocampal neurons, we found that the deletion caused a decrease in both spine numbers as illustrated here and synapse numbers as not illustrated here, of approximately 50%. So there was a loss of synapse numbers, very different from what I told you about Nurexin, where there's no change in synapse numbers upon deletions. Moreover, very different from Nurexin's, this loss was cell autonomous or postsynaptic, suggesting that this is due to a change that is postsynaptic, i.e. that the cladophilin 2 must be postsynaptic. As I mentioned already, but forgot that I was going to show it, there was also a loss of synapses, as shown here by these immunocytochemistry experiments that are quantified in the bottom, demonstrating that the puncta density, but not the puncta size, as measured with various excitatory synapse markers, is decreased to approximately to the same extent as the spine numbers. These experiments thus demonstrated that in cultured neurons, postsynaptic cladophilin 2 is essential for maintaining synapse numbers in some manner. Does this affect a change in synapse function? Obviously it does. If you have fewer synapses, you have a decrease in synapse function. And indeed, there was a decrease in MEPSC frequency as shown here, with a slight but significant increase in the MEPC amplitude shown here at the bottom. So these experiments suggest that cladophilin functions as a postsynaptic molecule that is essential for a subset of synapses, a large subset of synapses, by a cell autonomous mechanism. Obviously, as I mentioned earlier, this being in culture raises issues. So we wanted to go again in vivo. And again, we used stereotactic injections of viruses to probe this. But in this case, we used a different type of approach from what I've told you earlier to explore this, because we wanted to test specifically whether cladophilin 2 is postsynaptic, and we wanted to specifically analyze its effect on single postsynaptic neurons. We first examined where in the adult brain cladophilin actually is. And what you see here in this slide is an unlabeled section from a cladophilin 2 knocker in mice demonstrating the green distribution of cladophilin. And what is remarkable here is that in the hippocampus that is now outlined by this red box, there's a very unusual distribution in that you can see that there's this green line. When you analyze this further, you will find that this green line, which you can see here, corresponds to one particular part of the CA1 region of the hippocampus. It corresponds to what's called the stratum lacunosum maloculare, which is the most bottom part of the dendrites of the CA1 pyramidal neurons. This part of the molecule of the dendrites is contacted by synapses arising from the entorhinal cortex, whereas other parts of the CA1 region are contacted by synapses arising from the CA3 region. So we tested whether in this part that streak of latrophilin is presynaptic or postsynaptic. To test this, we infected stereotactically, as shown here on the left, again at P21, the brain of these Narkin mice with now lentiviruses that infects more sparsely. As you can see here in the middle, this green now shows that the lentiviral Cre infects the nuclei, and this green stuff here, which is still there in the uninfected part, is now gone, demonstrating that it's postsynaptic, which is the actual location of the latrophilin 2 in the stratum lacunosum moleculare. So latrophilin 2 must be postsynaptic in vivo and targeted to a specific dendritic domain of the postsynaptic cell. It's not just everywhere, it's only in one part of its dendrites. Is it actually in synapses? Without going into the details, it is, as shown here. And when you look at the synapses, it co-localizes with VGLUT1 to about 50%, suggesting that a subset of the synapses, just like in cultured neurons, contain latrophilin 2 in this preparation. So postsynaptic latrophilin 2 in CA1 pyramidal neuron is selectively targeted to excitatory synapses on dendritic spines. What does it do there? Well, not surprisingly, what it does there is maintain synapses. To analyze this, we injected mice stereotactically, even more sparsely with lentiviruses, that allowed us to analyze single neurons. As you see here on the right, these are the neurons that we can visualize, we can patch them, and we can fill them with biocytin for morphological analysis and imaging, as shown on the right here. When we do that, we can analyze the effect on spine numbers and synapse numbers in different parts of the dendrites of a single neuron, as shown here. And it's obvious that there's no change in either the stratum oriens or the stratum radiatum of the same neuron, but there is a dramatic decrease, again, in spine numbers of the stratum lacunosum moleculare. Does this alter synaptic transmission? Of course it does. Let me just illustrate to you how we measure this, because it's a kind of an interesting approach that you can use in slices. Specifically, what you see here on the top is a slice, and you can patch the CA1 neuron, and then you can stimulate inputs to the same neuron alternatively from either the stratum radiatum via CA3 axons or entorhinal cortex axons by stimulating in the stratum lacunosum maloculare. So you can compare inputs from different brain regions in the same postsynaptic neuron. In doing this, we found that in the stratum lacunosum maloculare, there was the same decrease in synaptic strength corresponding to the loss of synapses, whereas in the stratum radiatum, there was actually an increased response. Since there's no change in synapse numbers, there may be a compensatory increase in synaptic strength per synapse, which is also reflected in a change of the rectification index, suggesting a change in the AMPA receptor composition. So there's a selective loss of synaptic responses that precisely corresponds to the location of the spine and synapse loss, suggesting that the postsynaptic deletion of latrophilin 2 leads to a selective impairment of synapses in those parts of the dendrites that normally contain latrophilin 2, which is in the stratum lacunosum moleculare. This preparation allows us not only thus to reveal a function for latrophilin 2 in this particular type of neuron in receiving synapses from one particular source, the entorhinal cortex, as opposed to another source, the CA3 region, it also allows us to behaviorally test what the function of these entorhinal cortex inputs to the CA1 region might be, because we can obviously delete latrophilin 2 from the entire CA1 region and then test the effect of this on behavioral parameters. And these are the last experiments I'm going to discuss with you today. The behavioral paradigm that I'm going to show you is called a water T-maze. In this water T-maze, you train a mouse in a T-maze that has water. That's why it's called a water T-maze. You first train it to always go to the right. Then you open the arm, put the platform to the left, and then it has to learn how to go to the left afterwards. And what you can see here is that initially, the first swim, the mouse learns perfectly well. But the second swim, when the mouse has to learn that it has to switch directions, deletion, in this case measured of latrophilin 2 in the entire brain using a nestin cree, deletion of latrophilin 2 causes an impairment. So the mouse doesn't have an impairment in learning spatial memory. It has an impairment of switching, of memory flexibility, as illustrated in this experimental paradigm. These initial experiments were performed using a mice in which latrophilin 2 wasn't deleted from the entire brain using a nestin cree driver to specifically test whether this is actually due to those synapses on the CA1 region neurons that I discussed with you. We used the approach of deleting these neolatrophilin 2 molecules from the CA1 region using adeno-associated viruses. We did the same test again, and again, the initial first swim, the mice were perfectly normal. But when we tested the second swim, they couldn't switch as fast. They had a loss of memory flexibility. They couldn't learn how to switch. We also tested this with another spatial memory paradigm. This is a classical spatial memory paradigm, the so-called Barnes maze. Suffice it to say, without going into too much detail, because I think most of the audience here is not that interested in behavioral tests, the mouse, again, learned perfectly well, but it had trouble forgetting. If you tested long-term memory after 14 days, as shown here in black, wild-type mice, littermates, forgot. But the mutant mice still remembered just as well. Again, when we measured memory flexibility, without, again, going into the details, you can see that these mice were unable to learn a change in the whole location in the Barnes male. They were unable to exhibit memory flexibility consistent with an increased fixation of the memory due to a loss of the entorhinal cortex inputs into the stratum lacunosum maculare. I'm coming to the end of my talk here. What I've tried to communicate to you is that very different from the neurexin 3 story, where you have a specific confirmment, if you want, specification of synapse properties regulated by alternative splicing via the neurexin 3 molecules in the hippocampus. Here in the hippocampus, you have a requirement for this cell adhesion molecule in these synapses to maintain those synapses, to actually ensure that these connections are maintained. I've also shown you that latrophilin 2 here is postsynaptic. To the best of our knowledge, it's always postsynaptic, but we don't know this for sure. We think that it can still be a latrotoxin receptor by having a tight transsynaptic complex and basically recruiting latrotoxin to the membrane, although it does imply that the latrophilin molecule itself, as a GPCR, has nothing to do with neurotransmitter release, which I think is just fine. And so we think that latrophilins in general, as is now unfolding in further studies, are involved as postsynaptic cell adhesion molecules by interacting transsynaptically with presynaptic adhesion molecules such as tenuin and relaxins, in maintaining a different facet of synapses, of synapse assembly, if you want to call it that, the neurexins, by basically stabilizing these synapses. And what is interesting here in particular for me is that, to the best of my knowledge, this is the first molecule that is selective for one subset of synapses in a particular neuron, in this case the CA1 neuron and its synapses on the stratum lacunosum molecularum. So I hope I've convinced you, if of nothing else at least, that synapses are colorful, that they're diverse, that synapse properties and synapse assembly are dependent on a panoply of molecules, something like, if you want, a molecular orchestra that involves multiple pre- and postsynaptic molecules. I'm showing only one presynaptic molecule in this illustration simply because that's what I talked about, but there's many others. Understanding how circuits are organized, understanding the molecular logic that determines how synapses respond to activity, which is essential for input-output relations in the brain in general, will require an understanding of the signaling pathways that mediate synapse properties and synapse assembly. Not only the extracellular signaling interactions, but also their intracellular consequences, which have not yet been touched upon. Let me close by acknowledging the people who in particular contributed in recent years to the studies I described to you. Jason Arudo, who has now his own lab at the University of Colorado, did most of the Neurexin 3 studies together with Katsuhiko Tabuchi, who is now a professor in Japan. Garrett Anderson, who actually just left for his own lab at the University of California, did most of the latrophilin 2 work together with Anthony Bukar, who is now in Mexico City, again in his own lab, and Stefan Maxeiner. I have valuable collaborators at Stanford, in particular Axel Brunger, with whom I collaborate on structural biology, and Demet Arak, who is now at the University of Chicago, with whom I also collaborate on structural biology, which has been incredibly useful for guiding our molecular manipulations in order to elucidate the signaling function of various molecules. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any.
You described, I think it was 2,000 different splice forms of neurexin 3. How many do we have to study to understand the molecule?
Good question. I think these neurexins function as signaling platforms. As signaling platforms, each module is likely independent. I think we can treat these modules as sort of combinatorially, and we have to study each module separately, and then we can put things together. So we don't have to study 2,000. We just have to study those six sites of alternative splicing.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have one question here, over here, just behind.
Thank you very much for this beautiful, as usual, presentation. My question is actually about the current, about the modulation of AMPA currents in the other one. Did you have a look actually on the sensitivity, whether the sensitivity to the neurotransmitter changes, to the glutamate?
You mean if the AMPA receptor...
Exactly, yes, because you have the changes in the decrease in the amplitude.
Yes.
It can be one of the reasons.
So
can be just
there's changed. Fewer AMPA receptors, and that is because, and that translates in a decrease of the AMPA receptor response per synapse. And so there is a decrease in sensitivity that can be fully accounted by a decrease in the numbers. There doesn't seem to be a switch in receptor composition.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about, but it should be just... Did you have somebody from your laboratory measure
changes in the sensitivity?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, he's been done?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
What one here?
Okay, Tom. Thanks a lot for acknowledging my contribution to the original studies. And I have many questions, but no time for that. So probably I would ask only one of them. Latrophilin 2 is known to be a kind of ubiquitous protein. It's not only in the brain. And you mentioned that you think it has purely postsynaptic function. So what might be kind of analogous to postsynaptic function in other organs?
Yeah, good question. So latrophilin 2, latrophilins in general, are actually developmentally expressed in other organs and play an important developmental role. Of the three latrophilins, latrophilin 2 is the only one that's required during development, and it's required for heart development. I have no idea why. And that actually is corresponds to also studies in Drosophila and C. elegans, mm-hmm. where there's only two adhesion GPCRs.
Right.
One is latrophilins, and they have a developmental phenotype there. So
right.
like other molecules, except for neuroaxins, in fact, these molecules have developmental functions that are totally unrelated to mm-hmm. synapses.
Also, I'm just curious if you have any data related to the signaling that might be involved.
That's a fascinating issue that we're trying to explore. So the issue here is, these are GPCRs. Do they have to be GPCRs? Can they just be cell adhesion molecules?
They're heptahelical proteins.
Yeah. Do they actually signal? Yeah, I would love to know that.
All right. Yeah. Okay. All right, thank you.
One question over here.
Tom, I wonder if you know about this work when extracellular matrix was dissolved and lateral diffusion of AMPA receptor increased. So I don't remember, either Antoine Joulier did these experiments. And so I wonder if in your case you have changes in lateral diffusion, so AMPA receptors just simply leave the synapse.
Yeah, so it's a bit of a difficult question. There is much in the literature about AMPA receptor diffusion, but it's all with overexpressed tagged protein. I personally always feel a little hesitant to interpret those data because I have no idea what happens if you express a protein 10 to 100 fold above what it normally is and then look at its mobility. So I don't know what it means.
More questions? No. Okay. Thank you very much for this talk, which I found very clear, even for a non-neurobiologist.